Chapter 6, Shanghaied. As much as Jim hated AZ, he had to admire AZ's attention to detail. AZ was the name of the Bloody Eyes' leader. He said the A was the beginning and Z was the end. Jim was absolutely certain this AZ kid really meant Alpha and Omega, but it was unlikely any of these idiots knew what a Greek letter was. What AZ did absolutely mean is his word was the first and last. The gang followed him religiously. AZ's attention to detail is why the gang had such a vivid and exact style. Each and every gang member had a look that AZ had chosen to suit each one, and they knew better than to let him down. It was like an old 1930s mob boss demanding all of his thugs wear suits. But in this case, AZ wanted them to all look like they listened to Rancid. Yes, Jim knew about Rancid. He was 16 once too. The focus AZ instilled in his gang was an impressive achievement for somebody in his early 20s. How early in his 20s was hard to ascertain. Jim asked whenever he could, but none of the gang members wanted to talk to him. They did occasionally stop by to laugh at him, though. Part of AZ's attention to detail was the extent to which he put Jim in his place. AZ had Nate swap out the faux island setting for a 10x10 steel cage. The cage was complete with a square ceiling and floor, like something out of a cartoon circus. Inside the cage was an unpadded cold steel chair, a single hanging overhead light with conical cover, and a very oppressive steel table that would have been right at home in a 20th century police interrogation room. On the table was a classic 1985 IBM-style computer with a big glass monochrome monitor, which, of course, only displayed green. How this child, this 20-something kid, even knew about such an ancient computer was beyond Jim. It was almost exactly 100 years old. AZ even made sure the keyboard smelled like stale chips, and the keys were grimy to the touch. Bolted to the floor near the table was a 6-foot-long heavy iron chain, which connected on the other end to a large iron shackle around Jim's left foot. Now, you'd expect that AZ would put Jim in some sort of black-and-white striped prison uniform. But the colorful scumbag that AZ was, he went the extra mile to have Nate create a frilly, sparkly pink tutu for Jim that would have surely been the envy of any 5-year-old girl. But that was not all, no, no. In addition, Jim had a big red clown nose surgically attached to his face. It was part of his skin. He could feel when he touched the tip of it. On top of his head was a large conical princess hat with the word tool stitched in bright sequins. Jim also got a new body, quite unlike the beach hunk he had before. No, this time he was thin and old with a big pot belly. Well, Jim thought, joke's on AZ. I always used to look like this. His skin was pale white, even more so than Jim's original body, and covered in patches of black curly hair on both his arms, exposed chest, and bare legs. Picture the hairiest Greek man you ever met. And to top it all off, massive red clown shoes. But, much like the nose, the shoes were part of Jim's virtual skin. It was sort of horrifying, really. The fleshy shoes were nearly impossible not to bang against the steel table legs when he walked by them. Of course, with a thick iron chain, he couldn't walk very far. Just for fun, Jim wasn't completely alone in his virtual world. AZ made certain that Charlie the Shark came along. He had Nate give the shark human arms and legs, which it used to constantly circle Jim's cage looking for a way in. It would occasionally stop circling to leap at the walls of the cage and thrust a clawed, webbed hand inside in a desperate attempt to grab Jim. This kept Jim very close to the table at the center of the cage, well outside of Charlie's hungry reach. The virtual camera remained, pointed at Jim at all times, as did the floating virtual window to the outside. Both hovered close to the bars on one side of the cage. The screen's solid surface provided the only momentary relief Jim could get from Charlie's hungry black gaze, as its circular path would make it disappear behind the screen every minute or so. While suitable for a horror movie, Jim's new virtual world was nothing compared to Nate's very real one. After cutting off the boy's finger, the gang members were thoughtful enough to burn the stump with a blowtorch-heated knife. After slicing so many pinkies and pinky tips, the gang seemed to know something about first aid. The pain of his searing flesh must have been even worse than the severing, as Nate passed out during the process. Jim didn't think anything could be as horrible as Nate's first scream, but the second scream proved him wrong. And of course, AZ made certain Jim saw the whole thing. The gang whooped and cheered through the whole process. It was their rite of passage. They told him his new name was N8. But that didn't change anything. In Jim's mind, it remained Nate. In the days that followed, Nate didn't have much to say to Jim. The times when Jim did see Nate, he always had a new cut, scrape, or bruise. Nate was now the lowest member of the gang, and they made certain he knew it. While Nate assembled the freak show room that Jim now found himself in, Jim hardly said a word to Nate. AZ would stop by to point and laugh, as did the rest of the gang, but Nate and Jim remained silent together. On the evening of the second day, Jim finally spoke up. "Nate, I'm sorry," started Jim. It's fine, said Nate, cutting Jim off mid-sentence. Jim looked at the boy through the screen, but Nate only looked down at his keyboard. Jim struggled to come up with something he could say to relieve the unfathomable pressure and stress the boy was under, but he couldn't think of anything. We'll get out of here, Nate, started Jim, but Nate cut him off again. Shut up, hissed Nate in a low voice, as he finally looked at Jim through the camera and external screen. Nate's eyes were angry, but also showed fear. It suddenly occurred to Jim, far too late, that they might not be alone. Oh, really, Bucket Geezer? Where you gonna go? Said AZ, and he slid into view with all the menacing grace of a king cobra sliding up in front of a rabbit. Jim had assumed AZ had left the room nearly an hour before and was long gone, but now he could see how foolish that assumption was. For a man in steel-toed boots, AZ could move silently when he chose. It was another one of his talents, apparently. Hmm? Mocked AZ. Hawaii, maybe. How about the Himalayan Islands? Perhaps you both can sail away to Paris. Oh, I know. You can run away to Canada and start a bed and breakfast. Won't that be grand? AZ smiled with a grin infinitely more frightening than Charlie, which chose that exact moment to attack the left side of Jim's cage. It was as if the shark man could sense the panic filling Jim's mind, but the virtual shark hardly registered compared to the massive fear Jim felt seeing AZ. Its soulless black eyes and serrated teeth couldn't compare to the malicious grin and crazed eyes of the madman. AZ's arm slid viperously around Nate's neck, and he pinched and tugged at the boy's cheek while staring back at Jim with wide, crazy eyes. Then he looked at Nate, trapped in his arms, and said, "Would you like that, Nate? Would you like to run away with your little fish tank buddy? Come on, Nate. What do you say?" Nate started to uncontrollably weep and tried to shake his head, but AZ's tight grip of his cheek made it impossible for him to move. He could only let out a muffled, "No." AZ released Nate's cheek and smiled at Jim. "You see that, Bucket Geezer? Little Nate's happy where he's at. So what are you gonna do? Run away on your own? You gonna swim out of there, little fish?" demanded AZ, as his smile transitioned to bare rage. AZ stared at Jim's encasement for a moment, his eyes filled with homicidal intent. Then he raised his hand in a clenched fist, preparing to hit the case. Jim threw up his virtual hands, useless animal instincts trying to save his mind virtually from a very real impact. AZ stopped in place, stunned by the ridiculousness of the little absurd clown figure on screen, trying to protect himself by throwing up his arms in virtual reality, and then laughed. "Ha ha, relax, old man. I'm just messing with you," said AZ as his shark-like smile reappeared. He smacked the side of Jim's case in an almost friendly manner, but the impact instantly sent a wave of dizziness through Jim. "Now get back to the books," said AZ as he pointed to Jim through the screen, his finger so close it nearly filled the camera's view. "And you, little Nate, make the old man's nose a little bigger. I like it. Makes me laugh." With that, AZ slipped out of the view of Jim's camera. Jim followed Nate's eyes as he watched AZ leave the small room. After a few seconds, both Jim and Nate relaxed, each letting out a sigh of relief. After that, both Jim and Nate returned to their respective keyboards. Jim's in virtual reality and Nate in the real world. Jim didn't attempt to say anything else to Nate for the rest of the day, and neither did Nate.